Today, what I tell you about is what I think is one of the transformations which is going on in the field of computer vision, from sort of classifying or understanding sort of images or internet images towards more embodied visual intelligence, which wants to interact with the real visual world. And I will sort of give you some of the introduction to the field. My understanding is that so there is an audience with different backgrounds, people different backgrounds here. So I'll try to not sort of make it too technical, but give sort of introduction some of, to the field, and also show you some of our recent work in this area, and what are put so some emphasis on what are the important open problems in this area. But I will start somewhat broadly. And sort of just introducing you to the field of computer vision. So computer vision aims at extracting information from images. So for our human brain, or for humans, we do this very well. So you can look at an image like this here, and you can easily understand what are the individual objects, like the people or the train here. But also you understand what has happened in the scene and what kind of possible interactions you could as a human do in the scene. Yet for computer, this level of visual understanding is still far ahead of us. So we still are far from the capabilities of what a human brain can do. And just to illustrate that, I'm showing part of this image as a matrix of pixels. That's what the input to the computer algorithm which will try to extract the information is. So where the individual numbers are pixel intensities in this image. And the field of computer vision, I find it very exciting because images are all around us. Archives of visual information store images and videos or archival imagery, and cameras are all around us from so surveillance to car or even personal cameras. And I find this very exciting because all these data sources and devices, they record visual experiences of many different people from many different locations over time. So in my mind, they begin to form some kind of a collective visual memory. And what I find particularly exciting is what if we could automatically learn from all this visual data? And we may do many different things with this visual data, but one particular area which I find exciting at the moment is imagine that we could build machines which would learn from this data. For example, by observing people, how to do things, how to learn sequences of manipulation actions to complete complex tasks, like changing a car tire in this case. And those machines then could then go and perform these tasks in new novel environments, which maybe are dangerous for people, they cannot go in, or, I don't know if you can see this well, or give in some help, or give instructions to novice users to perform expert tasks, like in this example on this side. Or imagine that they could learn to localize and navigate. These machines could learn to localize and navigate from other visual experiences in changing conditions, for example, like here, there's a scene from day to night, or here a scene which is sort of crowded or empty, which changes over time. So the field of computer vision has had a great sort of number of successes over time. Since '60s, there are, probably you are not even aware of this, but the cameras are reading the license plates of your cars, or you know, your phone is running algorithms which can recognize people or identify faces in images. Yet in sort of last 5 or so years, there's been a lot of progress in visual recognition. So for you who are maybe a bit of outside of computer vision, here is an example of a video. This is output of a state-of-the-art object detection algorithm called YOLO2 running on a phrase of movie. So this is running real-time, recognizing a number of predefined objects and identifying in the image, like people or a chair, it says, or a tie in this case. But it's a given predefined vocabulary for which you collect training data. It works reasonably well, not perfect all the time. You may recognize the quality of the screen is not great here, but there is a person here which is not detected, for example, or these objects here are also not recognized. We don't even know what it is. This may be some kind of a sack full of some sand or something. So these kind of results were not possible 5 years ago. It would be very difficult, but we can do this now. Some algorithms even attempt to produce natural language fragments given an image. So here is the image from the beginning, and this is an output of an automatic algorithm which is saying there is a large building in the background. There are even people walking on the sidewalk here in the red. Yet you probably notice that there is no, so it's somewhat successful in identifying some of the objects in the image, but there is no mention of the train here or what's happening. But there are some successes in identifying and localizing individual objects, but overall, I would say that still the understanding complex relationship between objects and the seen entities, their actions and interactions, is still very much an open problem. So this is on a high level, kind of what, if you are not working in this area, what the state of the art is. We, for example, I don't know if you see it well, there is a ladder in this image. So it'd be very hard to recognize. But what would be even harder you as a human, you understand what would happen if you move that ladder that you can climb it. For compute, that this level of understanding of the sort of physics of the scene is still far, or these relations of being able to reason about the properties of the objects in the scene is still very far ahead of us. So in this talk, what I've organized it into sort of three sections, which I think are some of the key open problems, research questions or research problem in the area of visual recognition. There are probably others as well, but these are three which I picked, which I think are very important, fundamental, which we need to address. What I will try to show you is what is the kind of state of the art in these areas and some of our recent work on these problems, on these research questions. So the first one is, the first question is, what is even the right visual vocabulary for what we should recognize? In the example that I've shown before, that was a supervised problem. Someone has identified these are the 5 or 10 or 50 objects which I will recognize. But so defining what a visual vocabulary, what an object is, or even what an action is difficult problem. So here, just going to the, going sort of back in time, initial attempts try to manually design rules of defining object, like define an object by manually design rules. And this turned out quickly to be very difficult. Imagine how would you write sort of rules to recognize a chair, for example. Instead, it was quickly became apparent that you need to do something else, and that the way to go is learning from data and learning from examples. And the current, and this probably most of you have experience with, the current way to go is really to learn the representation from data, in which really you need 3 key ingredients, which are mentioned here. First, you need the do you see the arrow here on the? So first you need the training data. Here in this example are positive examples of chairs and some negative images of other objects. The second key ingredient you need is an image classifier. It's some kind of a function or mapping which takes an input, an image, and produces an output label, which is either plus or minus 1 if you wish, if there is an object or not in the image, if the chair is in the image or not. And then finally, you need some kind of a training procedure. So in this case, the function f has some parameters. Here I'm showing it really as a machine, sort of going back to the original perceptron machine, which has some parameters. You can think of knobs, which you need to adjust in order to produce the desired outputs on the training data. And more formally, there's a part of it is cut here on the main slide. I will try to explain what is missing. Is more formally, this is done by minimizing a loss function that we try to learn, a mapping f, which we minimize over the parameters here. We turn the knobs to minimize a loss, which is composed, which is summed over the training examples. So we have training examples yi So training examples X is the images, Y are the labels, plus or minus one, and we minimize some of losses on the training examples. We have N of them on the training data set. And for each training example, we measure the discrepancy here, the loss between its prediction of the function and the ground truth label, Y. So that's, sometimes we have also some regularization or constraints on the function, but I will not talk about this today. So this is the training procedure. In practice, probably most of you know that in reality, you require millions of these training examples for something to work well. You need a classifier with large number, also millions of parameters, and you need powerful training hardware in order for this to happen. And in this talk, what I want to particularly focus is, and you probably, some of you are or note or see what the problem is in this setup. How do you get the training data? Or where do you get the training data? And if you work on an applied problem, which some of you may be, you probably ask the customer what they want, and then you go and try to label the training data. And by the way, so what I've described so far, this procedure is very powerful. It's really powering the success, current success of machine learning. It's called supervised machine learning. When you gather training data for your problem, and you train a classifier to solve it. However, I have, so I'm going to show two major limitations of this approach. If we think of having a more general learning machine. So the first one is, this annotation is expensive. So here is an example. This is still a Pascal challenge image with all the chairs annotated. And you can, so annotating all these bounding boxes or even segmentation mask is a lot of effort. So this is expensive. Sometimes the annotations are even ambiguous. How would you label this? Is this a chair, a dining table, or a desk, or a bench? How would you annotate that? So now, and the second problem, which I think is even bigger, is that even if you have the manpower to do the annotation, it is not clear what exactly you want to annotate often. So, and the key question is, what is the right granularity of the visual representation? So in general, the visual vocabulary of the objects in the world is large, a priori unknown, and depends on the task. So even if you wanted to annotate, how would you annotate all the possible actions which you can do with this tool? Or how would you, in another example, how would you annotate, what is the set of human behavior which correlate with pedestrian accidents? So in general, annotating this visual vocabulary can be difficult, and we need something else. So solution to this is, so you don't want to annotate, so annotating the entire visual world is just, it's impossible, so it's very difficult. So we need something else. We would like to learn without having the human supervision, without requiring to have the annotation. Sometimes this is also called self-supervised learning, and it is one of the big open questions in machine learning now. How do you learn without requiring manual annotations? I split it here into three areas. One of them, so in general, we can refer to all of this self-supervised when you want to without manual annotation and on the machine to learn itself. Sometimes it's also related to unsupervised learning. So this is a terminology more when you want to learn only, people use it only from, say, image data without any additional manual and or any other supervision. An area which is also now getting a lot of traction also is, and has been around for a while, I call it here weakly supervised learning, when you want to learn from the visual data and all the available metadata. So this may be in the form of video and text, for example, or speech, or audio. And this is an area where I've done some work, and I've also shown you most of the examples will be in this area of weakly supervised learning. And the third sort of area, which is now also quite, so it was very interesting, is sort of learning by interaction with the real world. I will not talk about this here, but it's sort of really coming more and more into prominence. If you want to have machines which interact with the world, they would like to learn from this interaction. So in this area of weakly supervised learning, the running examples throughout this talk, which I like very much, is learning from instructional videos. So these are, if you haven't seen those before, there are millions of these type of videos online for different problems. So, and just to give you an example, imagine that you get a flat tire somewhere sort of far from a service, yet you have a mobile phone signal. So what you can just go Google online, how do I change a car tire? What you find out is a video like this, when someone is explaining you how to change the car tire, using the appropriate tools and using natural language, explaining how you use those tools to achieve the individual steps to change the car tire. If you don't like that one particular video, there are actually many online for different car types, different tools, which you can use a different one, which if you don't like that one particular one. And in fact, there are many different instructional videos for different tasks in both healthcare, gardening, or cooking, almost anything which you imagine. So we have been sort of running, it's now for several years, a project on learning from these type of instructional videos, where the goal is to, given a video or many videos like that, be able to extract some kind of an instructional manual, if you wish. So I'm sort of showing, illustrating this from, many of you have shopped in IKEA, and when you buy something, you have an instruction manual which you can use to apply somewhere else. So in this case, we would like to then, given this representation, be able to perform, say, the task in a new environment by a robot, or give instruction to a person to do the task in a different environment. So I will show you sort of number of works which we've done in this direction, and I think it's a very exciting problem area because it really gives you a difficult visual data together with sort of really natural language narration. So in this case, the input is a set of, the first work we did in that direction is a learn the set of steps to address, that compose the particular task of changing a car tire, for example. So the input is a set of instructional videos which have narration, which is here shown as this language. And the desired output is a sequence of the main steps which complete the task, together with some kind of visual and language representation, so that we can localize the steps in both the language and the video. So it's really segmenting the long video, which may have several minutes, into the segment which corresponds to, say, jacking up the car, unscrewing the screws of the tire. And it's difficult because the language, different sentences can refer to the same step, so there is a big variability in the language, and also there is a big visual variability in the videos. So these are two different videos where the different people perform the same action here. So unscrewing the screws using, in this case, hand, and the other case it's a foot. So it's a very different way of doing the same thing. So if we have any representation, we have to be able to cope with this kind of visual variability. And the approach which we taken here is that we formulated as a two linked clustering problems, where in the first one we analyze the language, the narration, to extract the main sequence of steps, which is shown here in different colors, and then use these steps as additional sort of weak form of supervision to localize the actions in the video, the steps in the video. And the reason why the supervision is only weak, because the narration doesn't give us the precise moment where it happens, but only approximately where it happens in the video. And it's formulated as this, and that's why I was explaining the equation before, it's formulated as a weakly supervised learning problem, where we learn not only the resulting classifier F, but also the vocabulary of patterns from data directly. So we learn what are the different actions directly So here, again, we have the input X, which could be the video in this case, or it is the video. Y is not now the output labels, but is the metadata. So this is the transcript, and we wish to learn the mapping from the videos to, in this case, identifying the different steps in the videos. And by solving the following minimization problem, where we have again the similar so discriminative loss on the data, where we measure discrepancy between the prediction and the sort of latent vocabulary with some regularization. But here the supervision is given in the form of a constraint. So we don't have direct supervision in terms of the individual steps. We incorporate the transcript as a constraint on the problem. So the constraints are key to the success because otherwise the problem would be under constraint, because we try to minimize over both the mapping, the learned parameters, and the vocabulary labels. And so just to give you an idea of how these constraints could look like, so we have one example. So in these videos, so what we have is a long video like this. And then we formulate here the latent Z label is the precise location of the action in the video. But the text only gives us intervals where this action can happen. So in this, so it's visualized here by the language gives us half a minute maybe interval or 20 second interval where this action may happen in the video. And so we want to identify the precise moment, and that's we have a latent variable here, Z, which is zero where it if there is no action, and one when there is an action. And we would like to identify where here the jacking up car action is happening. And you can probably see yourself, how would you formulate a constraint which would say that this this action should appear in this interval at least once? So how would you formulate this constraint in terms of the Z variables? That I want to have at least one occurrence of that action in that interval. So you probably see that you can formulate it fairly easily as a linear constraint on Z, and you're saying the sum of the variables in that interval has to be greater than one, that you have at least one action happening in the. So we can formulate this can sort of as the weak supervision, incorporate weak supervision as linear constraints on the latent variables in this case. So this was just an example. Overall, we formulated this minimization problem where we minimize the loss on the data regularizer and then have the constraints and different other constraints on the, which incorporate the supervision from the metadata to solve the learning problem. Here are some examples of qualitative results. So the different columns show different videos showing one of the steps. Oh, you can't see it. So here the first one is loosen the nuts. So we can see different videos where different people are losing the nuts of the tire, jacking up the car here. And you can see the variability of the visual content or removing the wheel. And one can also, this is showing the result as a video. This is the automatically discovered set of steps on the right, different colors, and here are the timeline. The top is the ground truth, and the bottom is the output of the classifier, which is identifying the different steps of the video, of the complex action in the video. So using this algorithm, we could take as an input maybe 20 videos of one particular task, like changing car tire, and automatically identify, learn the different actions, the steps, like jacking up the car, and localize them in the video. And we can also consider other tasks, like making coffee. It turns out making coffee is more difficult, which we didn't expect, which we thought should be simpler, but it turns out the narration is much more noisy when you make coffee, which you didn't expect, because people tend to talk about many other things when they make coffee, not just making the coffee. So that was an example of work maybe already almost 2 years ago, which we did on analyzing these instructional videos, where we wanted to learn from both the visual and the transcribe narration. And the scale of it was we had maybe 5 tasks, maybe 20 videos each on the level of data set of 100 videos. So, and the problem would be sort of solving relatively smaller scale, but still it would be the key was how do we incorporate this weak form of supervision in terms of narration. So a very recent, a follow-up on this is that, so we thought about how do we scale this? Can we really learn from much larger data set or much larger the amount of data? And this is the follow-up which I will talk about now, is that where we scale this work to much bigger data set in a way it's at the internet scale, really. So maybe some of you have seen before the page called WikiHow, which is a, you can think of it like a Wikipedia, really, but for different tasks. You can search for almost anything from how to fall in love to almost to how to make an ice cream. And it will give you a set of instructions which people have composed to do the task. So we thought, well, this would be a great source of data from which our algorithm could learn. So we decided we're going to focus on visual tasks, which, so we will so discarded all the tasks which were too abstract, like how to meet a friend or fall in love. This may come later, but at the moment we want the machine to learn how to see. So we focused on the visual task and compiled a data set of 23,000 tasks, which from with about 1.3 million videos, so each video would be maybe 5-10 minutes, and chopped it into short clips corresponding to, I don't know, 3-5 second clip, and we would have more than 100 million of these clips with a short, automatically obtained narration. So we sourced these, the tasks from the WikiHow page, and the videos we downloaded from YouTube. So it sounds like a large scale, but in the end, we were able to do this in a really university environment, so not sort of Google scale cell, but a university environment. In about a month, we were able to compile a data set like that. And the only manual correction was choosing the task. We said we want the visual tasks, not the abstract ones. So this data set is, so this appeared paper was just presented at ICCV in Korea, in Seoul. Just to give you an idea of the scale of the data set compared to other state-of-the-art data for visual and language understanding. This is the kind of a scale. So some of the data sets have from 10,000 clips. Maybe the one is to look at the hours. So this is different data sets. One of the largest ones that people have used are these, the LSM MDC data set, which has maybe 150 hours of movies, which is not bad, it's about 100 movies. But compared to this, our data set has more than 130,000 hours of videos, of these instructional videos. So it's really kind of almost three orders of magnitude bigger than any other existing data set for understanding video and natural language. So we have a big data set, but we've chosen to use a simple model. So we have a big data set, but a simple model which really consists of learning a joint video language space, which is, if you work in this area, it's quite common to learn a joint mapping where related videos are semantically related video and captions are close, and semantically not related are sort of far in that space. So that's the idea. Just for you who want some equations, we use a very simple kind of a few relatively shallow models on both the video, so pre-trained features, which are pre-trained on different data sets from video and both language. And then we learn a relatively shallow embedding to map these instructional videos into the command space. So these are equations for the visual embedding is on the top, and then the language embedding is at the bottom. So you can see there are sort of few nested layers with a, if some of it is a context gating, it's a layer which tends to work well for these type of embedding functions. It's learned using a max margin triplet loss, which is also one of the sort of successful loss in learning these joint embedding functions. I will not go through the details of the math here, but the intuition here that is that we want the dissimilar, similar video and similar caption. Here, this is sort of filling with water, as you can, if you don't, can't read it. We want that, so we measure similarity using a dot product between these embedding functions. Here, this is using dot product. We want the similarity of the correct pair, which in this case we assume it's the pair with the, which is the caption of that video, automatically extracted from YouTube, from the automatic closed captioning. So this is correct one, and we want this to be, the similarity to be bigger than the one on incorrect pairs, which are here in this case the same caption with a different video clip from somewhere else in the video. And similarly, so the same, the representation of the same video and another sort of different caption in this case, it won't be also small. So it's a fairly standard loss function, and we can learn such representation. And I just want to show you some of the results. So these are examples of top four retriever results given a language query like gluing here. What's interesting is that we can also do more complex queries, not just gluing, but gluing wood, and we get back examples where people are gluing wood. So this is very difficult because it's a quite, so it's a combined query. When you get cut wood, you get different examples. When people use different tools to cut the wood. If you do cut paper, you again get a different set of examples where people are cutting using scissors and cutting paper. So this kind of a fine-grained recognition would be a very difficult to do. But we can do it because of the scale of the data, because we have seen examples of that before. So these are too small, these are some of the results. I've been working on vehicle supervised learning for a while now, and I'm very excited about these results because it's one of the first times, and this is not, it's also other groups are finding this now, that if you apply vehicle supervised learning at scale, you can actually improve performance over fully supervised methods. So here, you can't read the numbers, but for here in this case, vehicle supervised training on that large data set outperforms fully supervised methods for a task related to instructional videos. The details are in the paper. And even more interestingly, if you use this model, which we learn on these instructional videos, as a sort of a pre-trained model, which we fine-tune for other visual language tasks, say on movies or in other YouTube videos, we can also use it as a pre-trained representation, which works better if you fine-tune that than fully supervised methods, which train fully on the target task at hand. So it seems like a powerful representation for video language tasks. And just to give you a heads up, we have a follow-up model. So this is a shallow model trained, it is done on a single machine, maybe in 3 days. We have a follow-up work now in submission, which we extended also to actually learning the entire representation end-to-end, and this sort of surprising on this scale, on this sort of surprisingly good results as a general video representation, which is good for a number of downstream tasks like action classification. But this requires much more computational resources to be able to learn this. I'm not talking about this here. But for this work, both the code, models, data, and demo is available. The data, if you are interested in using it, we provide the links to the videos. So you have to download them yourself from YouTube, but you can just download these videos. It's available. If you are working in this area of video and language. So we've seen examples of weakly supervised learning of representations directly from the data. So we were not given, in the last work, we were not given any sort of vocabulary of patterns what we want to recognize, or objects, or actions. Yet we were able to retrieve, you saw examples of three people cutting wood, cutting sort of paper, of some of these different fairly complex actions. So this is an example of where we learn the kind of the representation, if you use the vocabulary, from the data itself. Second important problem I want to talk about, which I think is also fundamental open issue, is generalization to new conditions. So we want our representation to generalize. And just sort of again remind you as an example, we want to recognize the same action here unscrewing the screw from very different viewpoints, say, or if it's done differently. Or is another example, if you want to recognize the same action like someone riding a bicycle from very different viewpoints. So here seen from a car and here from a surveillance camera. So how do you do that? How do you have design a representation which can generalize? And really so coming back to that formulation, what we are really after is asking, what is the appropriate form of that function f, which allows us, which can be learned, which can capture this amount of variation, yet can be learned from small number of examples. So this is really the question which we are asking here. What is the form of mapping of that f? And as many of you know, one of the very successful ones for visual recognition are now convolutional networks, which are really sort of these sort of nested mappings which take an input image and transform it through a sequence of transformations called layers into an output representation. And what's interesting that, well, these layers, many of you know this probably, is that these layers have simple form like this, linear with a non-linearity, and have these learnable parameters which we can learn from data. So these CNNs have been, they are really powerful representations which have transferable parameters. The parameters can be transferred across different tasks, which again is something which we use all the time. So they are good for 2D images, yet what are the appropriate representations, say, for video or other forms of data, 3D objects, it's still an open problem. There is a lot of work on this, but I wouldn't say that we have really find the right representation for video or 3D or for other sort of forms of data. I'll illustrate to you the power of this CNNs for visual recognition. Yeah, this will be very difficult on this bad screen for you. So this is an example for one of the first experiences with convolutional networks where we thought this is a false positive here. So do you see a person in this image? It's very hard to see. I think maybe on those screens it's a bit easier. In this one, it's super difficult. In fact, there is a person in this image. It's just sort of hidden next to the dark. But it's an example which you can really detect using a convolutional network. It's possible if we thought original was a false positive. We are working on this, and so several other people are working on this idea of generalization across different conditions. How do we learn CNNs or different representations which will generalize, say, across illumination conditions? This is important in autonomous driving, where important task is to localize the car on the road, and this is done using combining different information. One of them is using visual sensors, which localize the car with respect to the 3D environment. So it's called visual localization. And this module of visual localization, we want that to work across different conditions. If you have a car which doesn't work when it's dark outside, you don't want that. So in this work, what we've looked at is creating a benchmark. So this was data captured from the Oxford Robotics Group doing a car going the same route in Oxford multiple times. So you have videos like this when you see the same places in different conditions. And what we created is a ground truth for this, for visual localization. And different algorithms, one can test how they work for localizing across these different conditions. And I just want to show you one example of work in that direction. We've designed representations, and again, it's in this area of weakly supervised learning, that we rather than sort of going out and collecting data, we use data which is available, in this case was a street view imagery. So there is this thing called time machine where you have seen the same place in different time on different conditions, which was captured by the Google car going around the city or the world, in fact. And from these different imagery, we've looked at, can we learn a representation which will sort of generalize across these different conditions. And so these are some of the example results where these are the query images, and these are the best matches. It's really hard to see on the screen, but they kind of depict, this is the same place, this is the same poster from different viewpoint and different conditions. So we can actually learn a representation And it has to be learned for this task in particular. If you take a general CNN for classification, doesn't work as well, but you can learn a representation for this problem which helps you to localize images, and with one application is in autonomous driving. Another application of localization is indoor localization. In this case, we have a 3D environment of a whole building. We have a project now which the building will be a hospital, and we will have a robot which will go around and could navigate people around the hospital. A patient maybe come them, bring them to a waiting room. And again, for this, you require to have a localization capability. The robot needs to know where he is, where it is in the environment. So given a query image like this, it would, and a map, in this case, is a 3D map created by some offline process. It needs to recognize where am I in the environment. Here is an example of a robot by Pal Robotics. And it has to, the difficulty again is the map has been created, the particular case was created overnight, so there are these empty corridors in the university. But in fact, in reality, when you come during the day, it's full of people and the objects are moving around. Also, the map has been captured a few months ago. So any localization algorithm or representation has to be able to deal with these changes over time, so these changing conditions. And again, so we've designed a representation, a particular sort of neural network architecture, which can, for localization, which has been trained for these localization tasks from data. I'm not going to give you a deep much, so I'm not going to go into details of the architecture. I'm happy to discuss it later. What I will show is an example result where at the top, the key is to recover correspondences between the map and the query image. And the green dots are the corresponding points between the two, which are used then to recover the location of the robot. And this is a baseline method here. One of the state of the art is based on matching local features, and they are very difficult to extract in these indoor environments. And it really works much better in quantitative terms. So on the x-axis here is the distance localization error, and on the y-axis the percentage of correctly localized images. And so this is what you get using this kind of a, which was up till recently state-of-the-art baseline. And I'm not going to explain the different stages of the recognition, but using a learned representation, you can do much, much better. So this is sort of an example task where if you plug in a learnable representation, you can significantly improve performance. Going from, if you require 1 meter accuracy, you can go from 20% of correctly classified images to more than 60, which is a big improvement. Another kind of generalization is to new unseen objects, and I'm not going to talk about this. I'm pointing out two pieces of work, which I'm happy to discuss later, which look at recognizing relations between objects, like person riding horse, and especially focusing on recognizing unseen relations. So generalizing, maybe you've seen in training data, you see person riding horse and person riding bicycle. Maybe some dog examples, and you would like to at test recognize someone riding a person, like unusual relation, like person riding a dog. So really these generalization to these new situations and conditions. This is kind of this is very difficult problem. So this is I wouldn't say we've solved it. I think this is one of these open problems which require, I think, a lot of additional work. So these are different forms of generalizations, which I think are really one of the key open problem, at least in visual recognition. And then the third open problem, I think, is really it's interpreting and reasoning about the visual data. Now, what that means, we can sort of argue about that. I will rather show you some examples, which I would sort of say are towards sort of more advanced reasoning capabilities about the visual data. And the first example is relating the actions, what people do, and objects. So this is an example work where we would like to learn automatically from data how actions change objects. So this is something which happens all the time. We open door, we change the state from door to, from open to from closed to open. When you fill a cup, you can think of changing the state of the cup from empty to full. So these are things which really are happening all the time, and we would like here the machine to automatically learn from videos that actions change state of objects. And the questions which we ask here, which you can't quite see here, you can see on the other screens, is can we learn the set of, given a set of, in this case, instructional videos, can we learn what is the set of actions and what are the object states automatically? So again, an example of this vehicle supervised problem. We again formulate it as an optimization problem with a particular cost function, which I will not go into detail, but I will show you some examples of, say, in this case, it's pouring coffee, where we have, you don't see the bottom of the slide, but what we have here is three different examples of a cup in empty state. Here is a pouring action, someone pouring coffee, and here are examples of the cup in the full state, full cup. I'm giving you these names, but the algorithm doesn't know that. He just recognizes that there is a particular action, a motion, which changes the appearance of a cup consistently in the data. Of course, and in this work at least, we don't map it to any semantics or any language. So this is just recognizing these patterns in the data automatically and relating actions and objects. Here is another example of a wheel, so putting a wheel on the car, and again, so it's changing state of the wheel from sort of off the car to on the car, and so learned automatically from the data. Or in this case, opening oyster or opening fridge, and in this case, look at the visual variability of the objects and the actions. In the column, how the appearance of the fridge and the action is different. So, and again, we can then run it in a long video, which it will so fast, using language, it will fast forward to the particular segment of the video where the person is changing car. It will recognize where the car is in one state of the wheel, then is the action putting on the car and then off the wheel, on the wheel. And there are some more examples here, pouring coffee. So it's an example where we automatically make this relation between human actions and objects. And interestingly, quantitatively, when you measure it, I will not show the results, it's really both actions help objects and objects help actions. So somewhat surprisingly to us, the objects help actions much more. So it's also, I think, stays the difference between the state of the art in object and action recognition, where action recognition is still very difficult. So far, and I think this is one of the last works I will mention here, so far what we in this we've been looking at these relations of objects and actions only looking at appearance. We didn't really have any physical understanding of that interaction. And this is what we try to change in this work, where where the objective is, given an input video, which you see on the left, and this is an RGB-only video from YouTube, we would like to output the motion, the trajectory in 3D, show it again, of the motion of that action here, hammer, you know, the person using hammer on the concrete, and both the trajectory, 3D trajectory of the person and the objects, in this case it's the hammer, together with the physical interpretation. So see there are these yellow arrows here in the video, and these are estimated contact forces between the person and the environment, the ground and or the tool. So this is a given a single video, we would like to come up with a sort of 3D physical interpretation of the scene. And so this is how we do it, how we approach the problem, is that we have two stages. In the first one, recognition stage, we recognize the pose of the person and the tool, so we recognize both the 2D position of the person joints and the tool in the video. And also, we recognize the contact state. So we recognize, train a recognizer to classify which joints are in the contact with the ground or the tool, with the environment. And this turns out to be an important signal for the later optimization. In the second estimation stage, on the right, we, given this 2D information, we reconstruct the 3D motion of the person and the tool with the physical constraints. And finally, we would like to transfer that motion to the robot, which we haven't done yet. I'm sort of showing this as an example, but this is something which we are working on at the moment, is to incorporate the interaction with the environment as a additional supervision signal. But I will show you the current result. So this is a output video showing the output of the intermediate recognition stage. So in this case, you can see the output skeleton together with the mask of the object, here the size and the two endpoints of the tool. Here is another example of another interaction. So this is, again, 2D output of the recognition stage, where we recognize the individual joints and the tool in 2D. And final example, just to, you can see the range of different interactions and the level of noise we get from the 2D information. And so once we have this 2D signal from the video, we reconstruct, given this the 2D motion, we reconstruct the 3D motion using a tool from robotics, which is used for planning motion on humanoid robots. So it's called trajectory optimization, and it's a minimization problem where we optimize. Here the X is the skeleton, is the 3D positions of the different joints on the person and the tool. It's a sum over joints of both the human and the object. And here this is an integral over time, so we need to minimize it over the whole video. And the loss function, the parameters which we optimize, is X is the skeleton, is the motion. U are the control forces. So this is the control forces which generate the motion. So we have a physical model which generates the motion. And C are the contact positions. So these are the positions of the contacts with the ground and with the tool. So we optimize all of these, given the 2D signal, in 3D. And what the objective is measuring a reprojection error to the video. So if we project the 3D reconstruction to video, how well we project it. And so this is the cost, and what are important are the constraints, which are really the physical constraints. So they model the physics of the interaction. In this case, we have a contact motion model, we have a full body dynamics, and a force model, which is putting constraints on the generated forces. I'm not going to explain this in much detail. Instead, I will show you results. So we test this method, validate it on two data sets. The first one is on the right, which is a data set from biomechanics, where we have ground truth for the forces. This has been captured in a laboratory environment where we have ground truth, we can validate the method. And the second one is a new data set of YouTube videos. So these are realistic in the wild videos where people are showing, performing these different actions like hammering. And we would like to show that we can reconstruct this motion. We can learn the motion from these videos. And so here are some examples of qualitative results just as images, where we have the one frame of the video, and here is the reconstructed pose and forces as these yellow arrows from two different viewpoints, from a one particular video, frame of a video. And here is an example of a video. This is the input video of a person interacting here with a spade, it's a hammering, 2D output, and these are two different viewpoints of the 3D output. And again, the yellow arrows are the reconstructed forces. There you can see the small white arrows are reconstructed moments, and from two different viewpoints. So we really get a 3D reconstruction of this of these interactions. And there are some, we have seen some video, some of these hammering examples, another one. I'm sort of jumping through the video. Here is the spade. So in all these examples, we have a generic, as this is input, a model of the tool, which gives some kind of an approximate weight of the tool. So we and that's also the reason we can reconstruct the forces that we provide, not precise, but approximate weights of the object. It's a sort of single approximate weight for the human and the class of objects. Okay, so this was a this. So we've looked at these. So some example results in these three questions of learning. What is the learning the vocabulary of patterns from the data and metadata without requiring the full supervision? Because we really need the machines to be automatically learning from the available data, and the humans do not have to annotate everything because it's not scalable. Then we looked at generalization. We need the machines to generalize to new conditions because the conditions are changing. We can't expect the conditions will be always the same. We have to be able to deal with new situations. And then we looked at two examples of work where we try to do a more reasoning about the visual data, kind of physical reasoning in this case. We reason about the interaction of the person and the environment and the tool. And here I'm sort of putting as a fourth point, and this is kind of a future ongoing work, another key major challenge is how to act on the world, how we can now really connect these algorithms and these models to sort of real physical device like a robot, act on the world and learn from these interactions with the world. So I think this is one of the key open challenges as well. And just to illustrate, I'm showing a video. So this is from my recent visit to LAS in Toulouse, where they have this amazing humanoid robot called Talos, and which can walk, it can grab objects. This is just an example sequence of the robot walking. And our current sort of plan is to try to transfer some of these learned motion primitives, like hammering or shoveling, and try to sort of reproduce them on a robot like this. So can the robot really go and learn from YouTube how to do a particular task? So that's and then learn from the interaction with the environment. In general, I think now it's a very exciting time to be in this area, in sort of in visual recognition, machine learning, and the interaction with the world and robotics. So I think soon we will see more applications in specific constraint setups, both in, I guess, research results, but also in applications in industry. But I think long term, it's really exciting to attempt at least to build robots or machines which can autonomously learn from the data around them and the interactions, and can reason about the visual and the world around them and interact with it. So I think it's an exciting time to be in. And I also think that, and it's happening already, that computer vision will benefit and is benefiting from many collaborations with other fields like machine learning, robotics, natural language processing, or speech understanding. So I think we're also going to see much more of these sort of interdisciplinary interactions in AI. So with this, I would like to thank you very much for your attention. So thank you very much, and if you have any questions, thank you.